This is the Faith Fight Podcast. Today, we are talking about our identity in Christ. Hello again, everybody. Thank you for tuning in to this episode of the Faith Fight Podcast. My name is Chris Creary, and I'm so glad that you've tuned in today. I'm here to help you get your prayers answered, to encourage you to grow from glory to glory, and to ultimately assist you in achieving your God-given purpose. Today, we have a special interview with Reverend Marva Tyndale, and we're going to talk about how we can help our kids understand and walk in their God-given identity. Reverend Marva Tyndale is the founder of Real Identity Discovery Ministries. Her threefold mission is to engage in spiritual advocacy for younger generations, to restore personal identity foundations, and inspire the pursuit of purpose. So this is part two of my conversation with Reverend Marva. If you want to listen to part number one, you can go back to last week's episode and listen to it there. And I put a link in the description so that you can listen to it by clicking on the link. But without any further ado, I'm going to get straight into this conversation with Reverend Marva. It was really powerful. So make sure that you're in a place where you can listen and take notes, because there was a lot of things that we went over that you can apply into your life and in your family right now. So let's get into this interview with Reverend Marva Tyndale.
Another thing I want to say, so I've talked about becoming the change we want to see. I've talked about knowing God and first integrating and in internalizing these truths and then impressing them on our children. I've spoken about that. I've spoken about biblically for a biblical foundation. The other thing I want to mention is core values. Families, to help parents, to help children, must. The family has to have some core values. What is it that is more important, most important to us as a family? You know, importance of loving God first and loving others as we love ourselves. How many families talk about that? How many, you know, relationships that are important? Forgiveness, responsibility. What are some of the family's core values? So the child would know if forgiveness is one of my family's core values and helps me to know what. If I mess up, I don't have to be so scared. I don't have to go lying about it. We're helping our children also to differentiate between behavior and their personhood. Many of us as adults don't know the difference. We believe our behavior defines who we are. So we have to help our children differentiate between behavior and person. You are not your behavior. So while we don't condone the behavior, just like how God doesn't condone sin, He doesn't tell us we are our sin, you know? So does that make any sense, Chris?
Absolutely, absolutely. I'm sitting here and I know, like, you know, that I've known you for years, right? And I've been following your ministry for years. But it's like every time I sit down and I hear you speak or I have a conversation with you, I learn so much more. And I'm sitting here listening to you answer that question. And to the side here, I'm making notes. Partly for the episode, right? But then I'm sitting here, I'm trying to make sure I make notes for myself, because I'm hearing so much things that, you know, yes. And it's funny that you touched on Deuteronomy 6, because that's one of the verses that I use for myself to help with my family here and teach my sons the things of God. And you touched upon that. And there's so much things that you went into just answering that one question alone that, I mean... I think I need to go back and listen to this again, because it ministered to me. So that, like, you unloaded on us in a good way.
But yes. It was a good question, a really significant question, Chris.
Absolutely. Really, and I hope all of the other parents that are listening right now, because it, you know, I think a lot of parents, it's tough to be parents. It's tough to do the work required to raise up a godly family for husbands and wives, men and women. It's hard, but we have to ask God to give us the grace and give us the help so that we can do the work that we need to do.
Absolutely.
So that we can do all, so that we can help the next generation, right? Because these things that you were talking about here requires a lot of discipline from the parent's perspective.
It requires a lot of discipline, and it requires that they first experience it.
Exactly. Because
we really cannot give what we don't have.
Exactly. And that's exactly where I'm going, right? Because as parents, how can we know if we need help with our own understanding of identity, or how, yeah, if we are deficient in any of the things that you mentioned just earlier, right? Because mm-hmm. we may have, like you said, an intellectual knowledge of who God is, mm-hmm. but we don't have the relational knowledge, or we don't know how to have, you know, an open place where the conversation with your kids can be open, because we didn't have that when we were younger growing up, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. How can parents know if we need help with understanding our own identity with Christ, or if there's things that we need to do in our lives to become better at this for our children's sake?
That's good. It was Stephen Covey who, the seven principles of an effective, why am I bringing that up? And I can't remember the title of the book, but anyway, of an effective person. But anyway, the top principles, first things first. I just remember the first principle, first things first.
Right.
and Stephen Covey, that's all I remember. First things first. And parents, yes, it begins. And we, how can we know if we need help? Before I go on to answering that question, I don't want to forget something. I just want to comment briefly on something you said earlier.
Yes.
Using Deuteronomy 6 and that, you know, encouraging parents, mothers, fathers, and it's not easy to be a parent, husbands and wives, mothers and fathers. I just want to speak for a few minutes to the sole parenting household, single parenting household, whether it be a mom or it is a dad, especially if it is a mom, wanting to explain that this matter of God's identity as father is especially critical, so that it is not, you're not operating and parenting from a deficit. In fact, you are inviting God into that space. We all should, even when there's a biological father and a husband in a home, we should still be inviting God as father. So that's a very important aspect when there is one parent. And fathers who are parenting the household by themselves, recognize that your parenting and your fatherhood needs the fatherhood of God in it as well to be effective.
Absolutely, yes.
And so I wanted to mention that. But the first seven habits of highly effective people, that's a Stephen Covey book.
Good. I'm glad you remembered.
Sometimes my brain goes on delay. But anyway, how can we know if we ourselves need help? Go back to some of the things I mentioned earlier that are cues and clues for our children. Are we struggling with any of those things? Mm-hmm. Are we struggling with insecurity, uncertainty, confusion? Those are some of the things, and others may not know it, but we know internally, and the Holy Spirit knows as well. A big, big, big clue for us, how can we know if we need help with understanding our own identity? What motivates us? Check our motivations in life. What is motivating us? And earlier in the summer, I was on a Zoom call with you where we dealt with the matter of having the spirit of sonship or adoption, or the spirit of orphanhood, where we're struggling and fighting through life on our own because we've not yet come into the place of embracing our identity as sons of God, not sons from a gender perspective, but true children of God. And so being driven by works, by performance to prove worth or to gain acceptance. And again, a person looking on the outside may not see it, but we need to be honest and true with ourselves, right? Do we have a sense of understanding that we are here on purpose, and it's not a matter of how large or big that purpose is? It may not bring you on the front page, but you're here, you're significant. Do you have a sense of significance, a sense of value and worth? So right, those are things that will help parents to identify. Parents that are in the faith, and this is understanding their identity in Christ as a context we're dealing with this. Parents, we have to check ourselves if we're legalistic. It's like law versus grace. Mm-hmm. Some people think grace is making salvation cheap. Oh no. We need to show grace because right, we receive.
So can you just, for the people who may not understand what the word legalistic means, and can you just explain it so that we can understand, just at a very simple definition, just so that we can understand? Because I think a lot of people sometimes fall into that legalistic way of living.
Yeah, I just like to say that legalism is believing that it is what I do my actions, my behavior that makes me acceptable to God, and that I must do certain things in order to be accepted to God. Why that's not okay is that it negates the redemptive work of Jesus. Jesus fulfilled the Father's requirement. He fulfilled the law. He didn't cancel it. He fulfilled it. So we don't have to strive, as in the Old Testament, to fulfill the law, because we cannot. We need to accept by faith that Jesus fulfilled it. And so are we there thinking that, for instance, in some communities, and I've been there, that was even part of the way I was raised as a child, how you dress is an expression of whether you know who you are or not in Christ. No, we dress modestly, but I don't have to dress in a particular way
right
to be accepted by God. Does that help?
Yes, absolutely clear. Okay. I hope it's a little bit more clearer for those people listening as well, just so that there's no confusion or gray areas that we have.
So we're not condemning others, and we're not judging. Neither are we condemning ourselves based on performance and and fulfilling certain requirements to be accepted. And again, I make it very clear, I'm not saying Jesus did away with the law. He didn't, because the commandments of God remain. But they are summed up in this matter of love, loving God, loving ourselves, loving others as we love ourselves. So that's a matter of that. So I talk about defining ourselves outwardly by outward material or temporal factors. And there are many individuals, even parents, the outward things matter a lot. The show, we've got to check those things and the impression that we're creating. And and everyone wants to create a good impression. We have to ensure that that is not what's defining our who we are. Unable to relate to God as your heavenly Father. Are we able to relate to God as Father? That's another factor that's really important, because if as a Christian we find it difficult to relate to God as Father, then it means that we're not really in the place of our true identity. He's God, yes, and we honor him and we worship him, we adore him, but he's distant. There isn't the level of relationship that we are made to have with him. So, you know, to sum it up, that's pretty much it. The things that cause us to not have a sense of security in God's love. How are we with those kinds of things and the other motives that drive us in life?
So this is the final question that I wanted to ask you. I want to know if there are some Bible verses that you can recommend that parents can use to pray over their kids or confess their kids or just talk to their kids. I don't know about what other parents are doing. But I know when you were growing up, maybe going into Sunday school, they probably had memory verses. I know I remember having memory verses and stuff, and I still give them to my son as well. Right. Yeah. So I don't think memory verses are old fashioned, but I know that worked for me to help me understand those verses and help me to not only take them from up here, but to bury them in our hearts. So at a moment's notice, we can remember them. But what are some Bible verses that can be go-to verses for parents? You know, to pray over their kids, to remind their kids of, or to encourage them to have these as memory verses.
Memory verses are, I put them in a different category, memory verses in general.
Yes.
But because we're on the theme of identity, I am going to go and talk about some key verses for identity clarification, identity understanding.
Yes.
And the first one is Genesis 1:26-27, that God made humanity in his image and likeness, and he created us male and female. So significant. And there we get the creation intent of our sexuality. Important. So a child from a very early age, if that is impressed deeply, right now with what's happening with the education system, it may be a little bit Monday morning quarterbacking to try to say to them, oh, by the way, God created us male and female. Because the school is already saying that's not inclusive enough. You know, you've got to be. But if a child gets this in their spirit from very early, even if the school or society or culture is telling them otherwise, something within them is going to resist that. So Genesis 1, 26, 27, and I don't believe, I didn't teach my children that verse as a memory verse. And I don't believe very many parents are teaching their children that verse now. But we do need to teach that verse. It clarifies God's creation intent, but I also believe it gives us that sense, oh, I reflect God's image. Mm-hmm. And I reflect God's image in a unique way. And I share his spirit essence, because God, you're explaining then that God is spirit and he created us in his image and likeness. So that's a key identity verse. I talked about biblical foundations earlier. That's one of the verses that's critical for that. Psalm 139, 13 to 14. I'm a wonderful creation of God. You know, that word fearfully sometimes gets misunderstood, but I'm God's wonderful, awesome creation. And what's beautiful about that verse, that passage of scripture, Chris, is that it is so beautiful. You created my innermost being and you knit me together in my mother's womb. So a child getting to learn this understands God shaped me. He put his touch on me. I didn't come out with a nose the way it is because of by fluke. I didn't, you know, things, I'm not thrown together. You created my innermost being and you knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful and I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place. When I was woven together in the depths of the earth, your eyes saw my unformed body, and all the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. My son, my daughter needs to know God has a book that he wrote about me, and he wrote about my purpose. He wrote about my destiny. And the verse goes on, how precious to me are your thoughts of me. Can you imagine that scripture being read over a child even before they can grasp the meaning of those words, but help them to internalize this? This is amazing.
That's, you so know, powerful.
And a child may it's one of the verses that are really good for discipline as well. You know, a child is behaving a certain way. How do you think that relates to what God has written about you in his book of destiny? Have the child think about it. Mm-hmm. If he created you and formed you and had an intention, you know, so you bring things back. We are talking about verses of the Bible that we can use, not only to teach them, to memorize them, but integrate them into everyday conversation and happenings. That's why Deuteronomy says, talk about them when you walk, when you lie down, when you're doing something, and discipline using not just children obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. You know, talk about what's God's intent. Talk about the fall. Understand that we you know, verse that talks about we sin and we fell short of the glory of God. But John 3:16, God so loved the world, and that world is not just the world universally. I love to say, if I were the only person in the world, he would have given his son for me. That's how much he loves me. And if my son, my daughter, my child needs to know that. But before we go from John 3:16, let me get back to the purpose and the intent. I have one written jotted down here, that I just, a verse that's so critical. Jeremiah 1:5, where he says, before I formed you,
mm-hmm.
in the womb, I knew you.
Verse.
Isn't that a verse? And I even established your purpose, what it is that you would become. Again, Ephesians 2:10 is another one. You're God's masterpiece. I'm just going to throw these out. God's masterpiece. And the verse in Peter that talks about we are chosen, that's 1 Peter 2:9. But again, using these verses, not just as to memorize, but to really relate them to my personal experience. And here's a big one. And we quote it a lot as adults, but bring it down to the level so we can understand and our children can understand God's unchanging love. He was motivated by love in everything he did, but we understand from Romans that nothing can separate us from God's love. So when a child makes a mistake or makes a bad choice, that did not separate you from God's love. Because one of the things the enemy wants to do is to say, well, because you messed up already, because you're going in this path, you might as well continue. God is too holy for that. God doesn't, you know, care about you anymore. Nothing can separate you from God's love. You can always come back to God's love because he loves you with an everlasting love. Amen. So I trust that those are helpful. And he has given us, when we receive Christ, his spirit comes within us, the spirit of adoption. So here's this. This one is critical. I belong to God's family.
Yes.
He has given me the spirit of his son, spirit of adoption in my heart, Romans 8:15-16. And that means I belong. Even if the group or the clique at school, they don't want me to belong to their group, or I belong, and I belong to God as my father. And so even when children are experiencing bullying, they're experiencing pressures, when they know who they are, they're able to go to God as father and talk to him about who they are and know that they're not rejected. And even what they may be experiencing outside in school community or elsewhere, they belong to God the Father, and he's watching over them.
That is so powerful. So, so powerful. You know, I don't know if you probably did realize this, but as you were given those Bible verses just now, you remember earlier when we talked about the clues and the cues that parents should look out for? I had my paper here and as you were giving me those Bible verses, I was connecting them to every single one of those cues and the cues that you gave. So like you talk about one of the cues and the clues that you gave was a dislike of features of themselves. But do you know that you are wonderfully and fearfully made? Psalms 139, right? You talk about comparison, right? Comparing with others, right? Jeremiah 1:5, he already has a purpose for you, so you don't need to compare yourself to someone else.
Exactly.
Right? Just as you were speaking, I was making the connection to those cues and the clues.
I didn't go that far. But thank you for doing that for me. And I can see it now as you're saying it. I can absolutely see it.
That's Holy Spirit that stepped in and made that connection for me as we were talking. That was so powerful. And I think parents, we need to actually invite the Holy Spirit into our parenting so that we can make these connections as we are going every single day with our kids, amen, helping them to accomplish their purpose in God. Wow. Amen. Reverend Marva, this was so, so powerful. I don't even know what to say. It was just so powerful. Glory. We give God glory. Exactly. That's what I'm going to say. We give God praise and we give him glory.
Amen.
I can't wait to share this with everyone else listening, because I know the people listening right now are going to be blessed. Again, I'm going to put your link for your website and the YouTube link for Bite Sized Blessings in the description of this episode so people can connect with you and start to follow that 21-day Bite Sized Blessing playlist that you have. It's amazing. And the thing about that is it's just short. 1 minute. Each one is like about 1 minute or so.
1 minute. A 1 minute blessing.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Because the whole idea of blessing is that blessing is intended to bless our identity and our destiny. And children need to hear that all the time. So the 21-day challenge is challenging parents, even as through the school year beginning now, to do this for 21 days, 1 minute before your child leaves for school.
Exactly.
And blessing their identity and their destiny. And the identity blessing, I actually have it here today. May I speak that one over?
Absolutely.
The children?
Absolutely.
And
please,
parents, this is how you would say it today. Lay your hand on your child. Today, I'm blessing your personal identity. I bless you to embrace your one of a kind identity so that you live free from comparison. And you live free from confusion about who God made you to be. My son, my daughter, may you see yourself as a precious masterpiece of your heavenly father and find joy. May you find joy in discovering how special you are to him. and you close it off with the priestly blessing. And now may the Lord bless you and protect you. May he smile on you and be gracious to you, show you his favor and give you his peace. My son, my daughter, you are blessed in the name of the Lord. And that's where you send your child off. So there are 21 of those different blessings. And we believe that children will be empowered, protected as they go with the blessing of the Lord.
Wonderful. This has been awesome. Reverend Marva, can I ask you to close us in prayer?
I'd be happy to do that, Chris. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for being such a good, good father. We want to thank you that your desire is that we would come to know you. And the Apostle Paul prayed in Ephesians chapter 1 that you would give us a spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of you. So we would know you better, know the hope of your calling, know all that you have invested in us, the purpose you have for us. He prayed this in Ephesians 1. And right now, Father, for everyone within the sound of my voice, I pray that you would give parents, you would give children, you'd give this younger generation the spirit of wisdom and revelation to know you better. Father, I bless each one within the sound of my voice. I bless Chris and this work that you have called him to do of sharing truth in a way that's relatable to families and to individuals. So, Father, be glorified in all things, and we give you praise. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Reverend Marva Tyndale from Real Identity Discovery Ministries, thank you so much for, I was blessed by having this conversation with you. Every time I connect with you, I learn something new and just encourages me and helps me. So thank you for sharing what God has put on your heart with everyone else listening. And I'm sure everyone else listening was blessed. Thank you for your time to come on the podcast today. And I hope to have you on sometime in the future. I know this was a long time that we wanted to do this, but I hope we can connect again in the future. But thank you so much for being on the podcast today.
Thank you for having me, Chris. And I look forward to being with you again sometime in the future.
And that's it for this episode of the Faith Fight podcast. I was so blessed through having this conversation with Reverend Marva Tyndale. And I hope that you were blessed as well and learned a lot from what we talked about. Now, if you want to connect with Reverend Marva, as I mentioned during this interview, I've put links for her website in the description of this episode, as well as a link to her YouTube page, which will direct you to the 21-day bite-sized blessings that you can follow along and bless your kids every single morning. Now, if you are blessed by this episode of the Faith Fight podcast, go over to Apple Podcasts and you can subscribe on that app and you can leave a review. Write down your comments of how this episode blessed you so that other people can see your testimony and be encouraged to listen to this episode as well. And for those of you who have Android phones, you can subscribe and listen to the podcast through Spotify, Amazon Music, Audible, iHeartRadio, or whichever app you use to listen to podcasts. All you need to do is search the Faith Fight podcast and you'll be able to find this podcast and subscribe. Now, if you know any parents that need to listen to this episode, please share it with them so that they can listen to the amazing insight that we received through this conversation with Reverend Marva, and they can learn and apply these things that we talked about into their family. And I want to remind everyone that if you missed part one, you can go back and listen to it from last week. So remember to put on the full armor of Christ Jesus every single day and go out and fight the good fight of faith. You'll hear from me again next week on the Faith Fight podcast. Something good is happening to you today. Be blessed, everyone.